happy Valentine's Day. It is gorgeous out there, and we serve an amazing God. So you guys ready to worship? I hope so. Jesus, we love you. But God, I pray that this morning we would grow in that love, have our hearts, have our attention. Jesus, whatever we walked into this place with, we just lay it at your feet. Declare you to be God in this place, God, over our hearts. Be lifted up, God. We pray and ask, God, for more of your presence. You are the only King. We place you on the throne and worship you, Jesus. Come on, just get your eyes on him. Worship you, Jesus. Solid ground as nations rise and fall. Jesus, kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, name of Jesus. Whoa, whoa. We trust in the name of Jesus. While the old God, we lift you higher. You are the only are victorious.
You are the only King forever. Mighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious.
Declare this morning, Jesus.
You are victorious. There's no one like you, God. Almighty fortress, you go before.
the fear, all the striving, just lay it at your feet. I just ask God that faith would rise up in this place. God, that we would see your grace, feel your presence, Jesus. The life flows from you, God. Not from our efforts. Not from anything we can earn. But from your goodness. From your grace. Jesus, we recognize, God, that you are here. Your presence is here. You're drawing us close. We say yes, God.
Every heart I worship. never stop working, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, no, never stop, no.
Come on, some of you need to declare this morning. You don't feel it, you don't see it, but through the Bible you know it. Stops. He's always faithful. Come on, lift your voices. Declare it.
Jesus, even when I don't see that you're working, even when I don't feel that you're working, you never stop, you never stop, never stop.
Drop away. They just fade to the background. All we are is yours. Lead all at your feet. Jesus. All we are is found in you. Now is an opportunity. Whether you've walked with Jesus for decades or you're just coming into the possibility of there being more to this life, right now is a chance with your eyes on Jesus to just surrender. Allow Him to truly be the Lord of your life. What is it you're holding back? Lay at His feet. All you are is all He wants. So Jesus, here we are. All our hearts, our soul, mind, and strength. It's all for You. Thank You that You've invited us close. You're inviting us closer than ever before. So Jesus, I just pray across this place, the cry of our heart would be yes. God, You have spoken. You've declared truth. And we speak our amen. God, we live our amen. Our agreement, God, our yes. So Jesus, draw us close. Open our eyes as we open Your word. Soften our hearts, God. God, I pray You'd bring clarity to the confusion and speak life in this place. If we open Your word, God, we ask Your blessing on it, that You would speak, change hearts and lives this morning. We are Yours. We're Yours, Jesus. Not just Your creation, but Your children. So we invite Your voice. We invite Your Holy Spirit. God, do what only You can do in this moment. Be the way maker, God, the miracle worker. To You, Jesus. In this moment, God, we give You all the glory and all the honor and ask You to now speak in the powerful name of Jesus. Everybody said, amen, amen. I invite you guys to grab a seat as we get ready to dive in.
Happy Valentine's Day, everybody. Good one so far? It was sunny out, so yes. It's a good Valentine's Day, Valentine's. And another one of those wonderful holidays that brings up all sorts of emotions, right? Anybody look ahead to the passage of Scripture we're tackling today? I didn't plan it. That's all I'm saying. Yes and amen. The series that we are in right now, talking about the importance of God's truth that has been spoken, the importance of us coming and walking in agreement with it. God speaks, and He says, yes, this is true, this is reality. Question is, what do we say? What does our life say? How do we walk out our response to what God has declared? All right, so this is this yes and amen. We've been working through the Sermon on the Mount, an amazing amount of richness in here as Jesus is speaking, as he's declaring this truth. And a little while ago, as we were wrapping up last year, we tackled the Beatitudes, this first section, and this looking at these kind of essential values that are at the base of what it means to walk with Jesus, what it means to exist with God, to walk in relationship with God. And then Jesus moves forward and begins to get real practical, begins to continues these thoughts. That was just, he kind of laying the groundwork. And so just in case you're just catching up with us, over the last few weeks, we kicked off this idea of this yes and amen. And then we talked about the reality of salt and light, what we are called to be, right? Salt being our surrender, and really the flavor that we have in this life, the flavor of life is faith. All right, so if you want to, you can go back and you can check out these messages. They're all online, Facebook or YouTube. And one of these days, I'm going to get all caught up on our podcast, so we'll have all the audio tracks. They're kind of have to separate them out, but we'll get those all caught up pretty soon. Surrender allows the light to shine. We talked about with that salt and light idea. We don't just need more lights or more lamps, right? We need more actual light. And we were using that imagery of those decorative lamps. You know, they're a little hard to read by it sometimes because there's not a lot of light. The whole design of the light within them is to display the lamp. And I think sometimes that's how we treat God and his gifts and all the amazing things that he does in our life is, yay me, right? So, more light is what this world is crying for. And then that next week we were talking about the difference between law and love. How Jesus didn't come to forget the law, he came to fulfill it. Right? And he drew law deeper into this scary, messy place of love. Right? And that's where things get really real. And there's this question of whether we're going to live by the law or we're going to live by love. And there's a much stronger standard. And yet, if we decide to try and live by the law, because love is just, that gets into my feelings and into my intentions, and it gets into my business. Right, the law, I know, it's check the boxes, do the stuff. But if we try to live by the law, we're toast. The law is there. I mean, the law shows us how much we need the grace of God. All right, so we can't live by the law. And yet, as we talked about when we were talking about 2 weeks ago, last week was Super Bowl. Anybody excited after last week's Super Bowl? Anybody depressed? It was a little disappointing. Commercials weren't nearly as good as I was hoping. I know. I said out loud I was cheering for the Chiefs, so there you go. You cheer for the Beavers too. I've got a lot of practice. Yeah, it was quite the upset in the Civil War. For those of you that don't know, I bought we got a little Oregon situation going on here. For those... Just to catch everybody up, we've got a little Oregon situation. Beaver fan, duck fans. So, my dog has a new chew toy. It's a beautiful little duck. To be fair, it is putting up a fight. Losing game after game after game. Week 4, we were talking about anger and offense. Right? So as we've been talking through this, it's begun to get really practical. So 2 weeks ago, we were talking about anger, this feeling that one of my laws has been broken, and it must be made right, right? And the law doesn't have to make sense. It doesn't have to be an actual law. It's just something that you feel shouldn't happen. It's your law. It's been broken. They shouldn't pull into my lane, right? My kids, when they go to bed, they should stay in bed. It's a law. It's just my right as a parent, you know? And so we were talking through just this natural response to these things that we feel are these laws. And then this question of, do I want to live by law? Because that's what anger is. It's saying, I want to live by law, and I'm good enough to live by law, but you're not. So I'm going to be angry at you, because somehow I come out of this better. You know, if I take you to the eternal court of law, I'm going to win. Anger's a little naive, isn't it? So we tried to try to give some practical application. How do we deal with this? And the practical application is actually going to apply a little bit to today as well. Today is kind of a second part to that week. But we talked about, whether it's hatred or hunger or really anything, what you foster will fester. Okay? What you feed will grow. What you pay attention to will get your attention. Okay, so what is it you're feeding? Are you feeding the thing that's spiking the anger, or are you feeding other things that anger doesn't coexist with well? Things like affection, things like your place in the realm of authority, the assignment that God may have you on, or this question of awe. What are you in awe of? How much awe marks your life, or is life just bland, boring, just whatever you can make of it? If we are in the presence of awe, if we are experiencing awe, there's not room for anger. If we are aware of the affection that we have for someone or that someone has for us, it just scoots out anger, right? We were talking about those good days that we have, right? Where you're in love, right? Or someone, you find out somebody likes you or something you're in this wonderful Twitter-pated place, right? Why not? It's Valentine's Day. So you're in this wonderful Twitter-pated place, and that same person cuts you off on the highway. Go ahead. I'm having a great day. It's awesome. Off with you. Be blessed. You know, it's a different place. If we are consumed with affection, consumed with the assignment God has us on, consumed with the fact that we are under God's authority and others are under our authority. We're in this place of influence. We're being influenced. And we have a responsibility to influence our kids and watch over our kids. And where does anger fit in this? You know? And we're consumed with awe, the wonder of God, the grace of God, the bigness of eternity, how small our little situation is in the grand scheme of things. If we are consumed with these things, anger doesn't have a place, doesn't have nearly as much room to grow and to develop. It's going to pop up. But then what do? We remind ourselves of some of these things. So Jesus got a little nosy in that little bit here. He's about to get a little nosier on this Valentine's Day. As I said, I did not plan this out. I didn't actually realize until Super Bowl Sunday. Like, I was actually watching the Super Bowl, and I realized what we were talking about next week was falling on Valentine's Day. So let's read about lust and adultery. Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. It says, "You have heard the commandment that says, you must not commit adultery. But I say, anyone who even looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart." Can you see the greeting card? There is life in here. I want to take a look at this. This is amazing. Now, what this is centering around, really, this kind of blows through the image of adultery, because adultery is what the law addresses, right? This is like the pinnacle of this thing of lust. Lust is really at the heart of what Jesus is tackling here, okay? And so as it plays out in this final act, right, kind of there's this ultimate act, and the law addresses the act, but Jesus takes it deeper. He always is going to the root, just like he did with anger, right? He's going to the root. Let's deal with this. Let's see what's going on. So with lust, let's go. We're going to define it, and then we're going to deal with it. Okay, define it. Uncontrollable desire is this idea of lust. Same thing with anger. It's a consuming dynamic. It's a consuming force. All right, uncontrollable desire. It has to do with your life. It's something you are pursuing, right? It's a passion. Ultimately, it's idolatry. It is idol worship. It is placement on the throne of something other than God, something that is going to consume you, that is going to drive you, pull you forward. It's going to change the direction of your life, right? So there's this passion, and it is more than sex. Okay, lust has more to do with than with between people, right?
You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. Right? A little Sinatra. But there's this deepening that's here, and this is what lust is, this passion. All right? And really it goes a little deeper. I want to take you over to Colossians chapter 3. All right? Because Paul tackles this from the teaching of Jesus, that as it's been poured through, Paul has this take on it that does the same thing, takes us on the same journey. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. He says, "So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy, for a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world." You see this progression? Right? That word for sexual immorality, it's literally the physical acts of immoral sex, right? It's the idea of prostitutes, right? It's the idea of these actual actions in this realm of thinking. And then it moves into this impurity that's tied kind of whole life. Just there's a dynamic where there's been something that has been spoiled, something that has been dirtied, right? There's an impurity, and then there's lust, there's this driving passion, and then there's these desires. Spreads it out a little bit more, spreads it out, right? It's going internal, and then it's widening, right? These idea of evil desires. Right, not just lust as we think of lust, but just these evil desires. And then it moves even wider and deals with greed. All right, and this is at the root of what the law saying, you know, if you commit adultery, you're going to be judged. Right, at the root of this law, ultimately, is greed. It is the direction your life is headed towards. Who sits on the throne? What are you chasing after? What is pulling you forward? What is your passion? What is your craving? What are you after? Right? And it says, put to death. Right? This doesn't mean ignore or try to regulate or try to control. This literally means kill dead. It's just like it doesn't exist anymore. It is not alive. Somehow we've got to kill this thing. These things that are popping up, it's have nothing to do with it. It's not a little part of your life. It's nothing. If it's outside of purity, if it's outside of righteousness, if it's outside of holiness, if it's outside of being in alignment with God, it cannot be there. Got to kill it dead, right? Put to death, right? And then so we got to deal with it. How do we deal with it? You look back at Matthew chapter 5, continuing in verse 29, right? It's this unrelenting determination that Jesus begins to describe. So if your eye, even your good eye, causes you to lust, gouge it out and throw it away. It's going to be a very interesting altar service today. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Can we agree with that? I mean, just don't think too long about the process. Verse 30, and if your hand, even your strong hand, causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. Unrelenting determination to get rid of whatever is causing lust. Whatever is causing this root that pops up and show this, really this essence of greed is really at the core of this. Whatever it takes, get rid of it. Now, you gouge out your eye, you get rid of lust? No. You chop off your hand, you get rid of lust? No. And these are not symbolic acts. He's not saying that, you know, just, you know, a hand. He's like, it doesn't matter, your strong hand, your good eye. You know, in this time, there wasn't a lot of sympathy for lefties. Right? Everything was geared towards right-handed. Your military, how you held your shields, how you lined up, everything was dependent on right-handed warriors. Your eye, your right eye peeks around the shield, right? Your right hand is the one that is attacking. You're dealing with jobs and tools, and everything is designed for your strong hand, for your good eye. He's saying even if it costs production in your life, if it costs reputation, if it costs your ability to live life the way you think you want to live it, it's not worth it. It's not worth it
if it gets to your heart. It's not worth it if it allows sin in. It's not worth it if it robs you of life. Doesn't matter how much you enjoy it if it takes life away. If it moves you from God, can't be there. Got to kill it dead, right? So there's this good eye, this strong hand, okay, whatever it takes. Now, there's an imagery that's here. There's an eye, there's a hand, and there's a heart. Eye, hand, heart. And there's a flow that is being pictured here, okay? What is the eye? Everything that is coming into your world, everything that is coming into your heart, coming into your thoughts, coming into and influencing you. What is your hand? Everything that flows out of your heart, everything that flows out of your hand. Now let's zoom out a little bit more. What is anger? Anger is about everything that is coming into your life, right? This is what you're responding to, is whatever is coming at you, coming in. What is lust? It's about what's going to come out of your life. There's this flow, and stuck in the middle is you, your heart, your soul, your mind. You are in the middle, and there's an inflow and there is an outflow. And Jesus is dealing with it all. And he's saying you can't deal with one. There's this whole picture of your life that we have got to take into consideration. And at the center of it is what? Your heart. Right? And the heart is the center both practically and personally, right? Practically, you look at Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. It says, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. The heart is practically going to produce your life, so guard it. Right? Personally, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15. There is a call of God to you and to me. There is a call from our Creator to what we were created for. Verse 15 says, but now you must be holy in everything you do. Just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy, for I am holy. There's this call, and holiness is the same thing as righteousness, the same thing as purity. This image of being in the presence of God, being one with God, of there not being no separation, no difference. Right? We are in step with God. Holiness is this other place. Right? It's not just what we do. It's not what we allow in. It's not just what we go out. We are in this place of relationship with God. There's this place of holiness. God is other. We need to join him in this place of holiness. And we can't judge it. We can't figure it out by the rules of this world. We have to be with God. That is the call. That is the invitation. That's the challenge, is to be with God. There's this place of holiness, of righteousness. In other words, things are right in reality. What God declares to be right, we are there. That's righteousness, is in agreement with God. It's walking out this amen. Holiness and purity. All right, so I want to take a look at this flow for a second, right? And it's permission. And there's this permission to what we give flowing into our life. And then there is this passion that flows out of our life. And stuck in the middle is this question of purity. It's our heart. It's our mind. It's our soul. Right? It's who we are as a person. It's stuck in the middle between what we give permission to and what we engage passionately. There's this flow through our life. And stuck in the middle is this question of purity. All right? Does that make sense? I want to take a look at several scriptures here. We're just going to blaze through them. And I want to look at this relationship between permission that's flowing in, the question of purity, and the question of what's flowing out of our life, what we allow to flow, the eye, the heart, and the hand. Okay? There's this flow that is constantly happening in our lives. Right? You gouge out the eye, you're not going to fix the heart. You chop off the hand, you're not going to fix the heart. But you adjust the eye and the hand, and you've got a chance to help regulate what's going on in the heart. You've got a chance to help purify you. All right, so let's look at this relationship. All right, 1 Peter chapter 1, we're going to back up from where God says, be holy. These are just the two verses before that. Verse 13 and 14. It says, so this is permission, right? So prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. That word, prepare your minds for action, is literally the phrase, gird up the loins of your mind. All right? So they used to wear the robes, right? Everybody seen a Bible play? All the bathrobes out there? Sheets and, right? That's hard to run in. I don't know if you've tried. I'm not going to admit whether I have or not, but if you've tried to run in a dress, it can be challenging. So what they would do is they would literally grab the back hem, pull it up, tuck it into the belt, and create capris. Right? Aladdin-style capris. Right? You pull it up, you gird up the loins of your mind, get everything out of the way of what you want to do. They do not give permission for that dress, that robe, to flow around wherever it wants to and get in your way. They deny it permission, and they gird up the loins of the mind, right? They prepare their minds for action, get ready to run, and exercise self-control. And then passion, put all your hope, right? You're looking forward, put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Christ Jesus is revealed to the world. You must live as God's obedient children. Right? This is what we are headed towards. Our hope is locked on Him. We're looking towards eternity. We're not living for now. We're living for them. We're not living for us. We're living for Him. And then switches back. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. Right? Deny that permission. You didn't know any better then. So it's time to change. It's time to switch. Right? Colossians chapter 3. We're going to back up. We read verse 5. Right? Where it said, you know, put to death these things? Well, let's back up a little bit. Verses 1 through 3 says, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, right? And then he switches to this idea of permission. What are you going to allow permission to? Not the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. Go over to Hebrews chapter 12, right? These first few verses. Permission. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. Gird up the loins of your mind, right? Get the junk out of the way. Deny it permission. And get ready to move. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. That God passion. Right? We do this by keeping our eyes on who? Jesus. The champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, what did he do? Right? He adjusted his passion. He kept his eyes on where they needed to be. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people. Then you won't be weary and give up, because it's not easy, is it? It's not easy to put to death the things that are natural in our gut and in our emotions and in our feelings and what we want. Verse 4, he switches. After all, you have not yet given your lives in your struggle against sin. It could be a whole lot harder. If you're still breathing in this fight against sin, you haven't done everything you can yet. Right? So there's more that we can guard. There's more permission we can deny. There's more ways we can protect. And there's more that we can pursue. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, probably a really familiar one to many of us. Right? This is both a mix of what you are passionately pursuing and at the same time denying permission to other things. Because when you make a choice towards something, you're automatically choosing not to do thousands of other things, right? Being here, you can't be an infinite number of other places, can you? Right? Except for in Zoom. That has now widened our reality. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts. What is true, honorable, right, pure, lovely, and admirable. Think about things that are excellent, worthy of praise. Right? There's this thing that we are choosing to. I talk to my girls all the time. I had a bad dream, or I can't stop thinking about this thing. We're trying to get them to sleep, right? So this is very important now that we have this conversation and calm them down, right? This conversation takes on a whole new weight when it's time for bed. And so we're talking through, how do I stop thinking about this? You don't stop thinking about it by not thinking about it, do you? It doesn't work. All you do is think about it. So how do you get rid of the bad thought? How do you stop thinking about the bad dream? You pick what you're going to think about. You pick your passion, right? And in doing so, it crowds out other thoughts. So every time that thought pops up, and it will pop up again, it's a process. Every time that thing pops up again, you choose what you're going to think about. You change your thought. What does it say? Take captive every thought. Submit it to Christ. So what is it you want to think about? You change your thoughts by choosing your passion. Not just by denying permission, but by also defining your passion. Right? You got to cut it off and pursue. It's both. So there's this process of choosing. And it's tough because how many of you guys live in real life? Right? Not any avatars here. We're living and breathing. You go to a job. I worked for the city of Sitka for a few years, which is my high bar now for language use. Up here, that's the one to beat. You know, they got creative with their cussing. It was impressive. You know, I was like, hats off, man. Of course, you could have told me you had eggs for breakfast in like this many words. But, literally, we had a conversation, and he's like, I really don't sound very smart when I do that, do I? I'm like, no, not really. So, we live in real life. Anybody else? School, work, jobs, stories that are told, language that is used, stuff that's around. It's there, and in all forms, right? We're talking about, we're talking about greed. We're talking about, stuff in the area of sex. We're talking about stuff in the area of language use and just multiple different things. A dishonesty, comparison, life comparison. There's all this stuff. Anybody else have Facebook? Anybody else watch HGTV? House hunting? Right? You know, sometimes that can compete with what you are called to do. And you end up wrapped up with the house you will eventually have one day. You know what I mean? And so how do we deal with this real life and this language that I'm around all the time and this content that's just nonstop? And there is grace for the call. There is grace for where God has called you to be. Okay? But there is a difference between grace for real life and grace for your entertainment. Okay, let me give you a couple of for instances. Okay, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. After the fiery furnace and God massively delivers them, they very well may have burnt their mouths on their coffee the next morning. Does that make sense? They still didn't jump into fires after the fiery furnace, but there was grace for where God had called them to be. How about the 5,000 that Jesus fed? Anyone want to bet they packed their lunches the next day? Right? Daniel in the lion's den still had to obey zoo rules. There was grace for where God had called them to be, and yet for real life, there is still standards that God is calling us to. A place of holiness where we are denying permission when we have the opportunity to deny permission to things coming into our life. And denying, things flowing out of our life, choosing what we are going to passionately pursue. There is a call to holiness and to purity that we have a role to play in. Right? And God will guard you. He's not calling you to live in a bubble. He's calling you to be in the world. Right? Go into all the world. But don't become the world. Go into the world. and carry Jesus. Be the light, be the salt. But if the salt loses its saltiness, it's stupid. It makes no sense. Literally, that word is moros. Makes no sense. Silly, useless. If we lose our holiness, if we lose our place with God as we are walking through this life, we make no sense. So God is calling us to this place of our eye and our hand affecting our heart. All right? And there's a very helpful, I love Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. There's an image that God uses here where he describes Scripture, the Word of God, as being sharper than any two-edged sword, right? Dividing between soul and spirit, between bone and marrow, right? Verse 12, for the Word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Now, what it's speaking to there is the sharpness. It's not a physical sharpness, right? It's this clarity that the Word of God brings where it separates out, what does it say, joint and marrow. What is the life-giving and what is the shell? Joint and marrow. Between bone, marrow. What, between soul and spirit. What is you, the soul, and what is the spirit, God? Because how many of you guys know that gets confusing? What I want to do, what I'm feeling, what I feel I should do in life. How do I know what's God and what's not? Get familiar with the Word of God. Let that be pouring into your eyes and into your ears and into your life. Let that be influencing you more than anything else, and you will begin to separate out what is your soul, what is your personality, what is your thoughts and your emotions, and what is the Spirit of God. And when we allow the Spirit of God to grow, it will influence and affect our soul, and it will shape us from the inside to the outside. So what we allow in affects us. You know, I was thinking through this and this anger, us, lust dynamic. You ever notice, I don't know if you guys know this, but there's a lot of times when people are struggling with this side, this lust outflow, things playing out in life that are just not healthy. Oftentimes there are triggers from the anger side. There are triggers from what has come into their life, what they have allowed to influence them and affect them, and it has changed the purity of their heart, and it begins to flow out of them in unhealthy ways. All right, there's this flow in life that is constant. It's a reality, and if we just check one, just check the other, or don't check anything, it's not going to be healthy. God's calling us to watch what is flowing in and watch what is flowing out. As the worship team comes back, you know, I really think we need to develop a personal cancel culture. Right? Cancel culture is kind of big right now, and it's all about fixing things for everyone. I think we need to take a little personal responsibility and have a personal cancel culture. What are things that I need to eliminate in my life? What are things that are not healthy, and that's just not going to be for me? I can't do this. All right? There's this two sides of it. Permission denied, passion defined. Right? Permission denied. There's this canceling that happens. You know, for some of you, I'm just going to give some ideas. Just going to throw these out here. Right? Some of you, it would be better to go through life without Netflix than to end up with your heart being lost. And it's not because Netflix is so bad. It's because it's affecting you. It is a portal for you to allow things into your life. And it would be better for you to lose Netflix or Hulu or whatever. YouTube. Friendships. There may be some friendships that would be better for you to move forward in life without these friendships because of the influence that they are having on you. Not that no one can be friends with them, but for you, it's not healthy now. HGTV, anybody could jump on board with that one? Facebook? Oh man, there is so much. If we bring this back to this root of greed, anything coming into your eyes, I mean, HGTV, I love a lot of beach hunters, right? I love house hunters. It's just fun to watch, but you have to be careful, don't you, as you're watching these rehab shows and these houses that, you know, this family is going to get their little vacation beach cottage, and you know, it's just the second home, so it's just $550,000, and it's just, you know, they really want to downsize so they can get away and be quiet as a family. And you know, it's just, you know, what is feeding you? Look on Facebook at everyone else's highlight reel. How is it affecting you? All right. Maybe you need to take a different route home. Maybe it's something as simple as where you choose to walk, where you choose to drive, and that for you, you need to change it, right? Maybe you need to change how you unwind in the evening, right? Money, finances, what is feeding your thoughts about finances? What is feeding your feeling about where you're at in life? Is there anything that is sparking in this area of lust, of passion, of drive that isn't healthy? Now, here's a question. Is it, when you choose not to deny permission to something, the question is, are you immune to it? Is it something that doesn't affect you, therefore it's okay, it's healthy? Or are you just numb? I just want to encourage you, ask it honestly. When you're figuring out, God, what am I allowing into my life and how is it affecting me? For some of you, TV mature needs to not be an option, period. I would say everyone, but I'm just going to leave it at, for some of you, TV mature, look at your ratings. What are you allowing into your home? What are you allowing into your life? And ask yourself the question, is it not affecting you because you are immune or because you're numb? Should you be being affected by it? Because that can be healed. That can grow back. What's the passion? If we're denying permission, what is the passion that we are defining? On this Valentine's Day, I want to encourage you, make your spouse a passion. Right? I pray that there is all this that we're talking about. I pray that there's some lust-esque type dynamics in our marriages. I pray that there is some craving for your spouse. There is some pursuit and some desire for your spouse. Maybe it's for a future spouse, right? You can pursue your spouse by how you take care of your heart. You can pursue the one by becoming the one. But for those of you that are in a relationship, can I just give you just a random piece of observation? Not looking at another woman, not looking at another person, does not equal falling in love. You must, but also not looking is a very good thing. Can we agree? But then you have to add to it pursuit. Pursue your spouse. Fall in love with your spouse. Don't let falling in love happen to you. Chase it down. What does it say in Philippians 4:8? Fix your thoughts on what is true. Don't make up lies about them. Right? You don't have to fix your thoughts on things that aren't true about them and try and wish that they were true. That doesn't work. Find out the things that you can focus on and encourage them, speak life to them. I really think there is, you know, we think through, and of course this thing kicked off with adultery, and there's divorce, and there's loss, and there's marital strife, and there's issues, there's a whole bunch of junk that's out there, right? Because we're people. No one's gonna walk through this perfectly. Nobody in here, and I'm looking at the Swaneys, and I'm just like, awesome. I love you guys. And how long have you guys been married? 60 years. I love it. That's awesome. You know, I want to grow into that. And there's this amazing thing. And yet none of these couples in here, none of us are operating out of purity, at least not completely. We've got junk flowing in. We got junk flowing out. And yet all of these things that are so heartbreaking that we look out and see speak to what is possible. Speak to the goodness of what God has designed. I want to encourage you, appreciate what you have in your spouse, in your kids, in your situation. If you're living indoors, appreciate it. If you have a spouse, appreciate it. If you have a spouse who loves you, deeply appreciate it. If you've got kids, appreciate it. Focus in, fix your thoughts on what is, what does it say? What is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Do this in your spouse. I want to encourage you also, figure out your God passion. What is your gifting? This is something that we can chase after. What are your talents? Chase after, develop. There is a lot in this life to chase after. And what happens is we get so distracted with the things we don't have, with the things we're not called to, that we miss out on these incredible passions sitting right in front of us, or for some of us, sitting beside us. One of my greatest passions is downstairs doing kids ministry right now. Lindsay's down there this week, in case you're wondering. Man, I appreciate all our kid teams. They're doing such a phenomenal job down there. But Lindsay, you know, we are in a year from this summer, we'll be able to say decades. This is 19 for us this summer. And it is a journey and a process and so much left on this journey for us to grow into. And it has had to be intentional. It's passion God has placed in your life. What is God calling you to? Who are you becoming? For some of you, one of these passions God's calling you to might be your health. Dump some energy into that. Dump some focus into that. Right? And back to what we were talking about 2 weeks ago, affection and awe. Give permission for affection and awe to flood your life. Deny permission for anything that robs you of it, that robs life. As we get ready to close, I'm going to read this Psalm chapter 24. It's a familiar passage. It's one of my favorites. It's just such an amazing picture and an image. I'm going to invite you to stand. The psalmist says, "Who may climb the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Only those whose hands and hearts are pure, who do not worship idols and never tell lies. They will receive the Lord's blessing, have a right relationship with God their Savior. Such people may seek you and worship in your presence, O God of Jacob." How many of you guys want to be in God's presence? Can I tell you? That is the place. If we can make our primary source of influence coming into our life Him, if we can make Him our first focus, if we can make Him the first filter for what we do, everything else will be affected. Everything else will be determined by that. How much He affects us determines our life. It will affect our marriages. It will affect our child raising. It'll affect our financial stewardship. It affects everything. So what I want to do is as we get ready to close, I just want to just get our eyes on Jesus. That first passion, that first direction, that first consuming. You know, it's lust in the healthiest, purest form. A consuming passion. It is the right thing on the throne. So let's just get our eyes on Jesus. Long for you, God.
It's our prayer, God. To be close to you, to know you more, Jesus. And draw me close to you. Just get along with him. Never let me go. Saturate our hearts in your truth. Pray you'd bring clarity, God. And God, I pray that you would speak to each person here. God, what do you want us to practically do as we leave this place? How do we decide permission? How do we pursue passion? What are you calling us to? What are you calling us to lay down? What are you calling us to run after? Jesus, I pray that every marriage in this place would be marked by pursuit for one another. As it says in Ephesians, that we would submit ourselves one to another. We would pursue our spouse, God. We would serve our spouse. And that our homes would be defined by love, God. Such amazing blessing is waiting in obedience. So draw us close, Jesus. Help us guard our eyes. Help us control our hands. And Jesus, guard our hearts. Submit ourselves to you, Jesus. And God, we celebrate your love for us. And you are the author of love. God, you are the author of romance. Jesus, I just pray that you take our marriages deeper. Deeper and deeper and deeper. As we surrender ourselves to you, Jesus. We thank you for your incredible blessings in our life. And ask you to help us walk out our faith as we leave this place. In the powerful name of Jesus, everybody said, amen.